Okay. Probably the warmest day it's going to be for the end of the year here. We're in December now, and it's been a pretty pleasant autumn. And today it's in the 70s, so after today it's supposed to get cooler. But anyway, this talk, I think I'm going to try to explain thoughts or try to come up with the whole idea of thinking. I'm not sure I had begun to think in my life. A lot of times I paused in my mind and I had a thought emerging that I thought was my own thought, or a thought that I'd had all by myself, and I couldn't contain it or hold on to it. It was like a sinewy, it was like a very fragile thing. And I'm wondering if, you know, thoughts are a collective, really, reality on the earth, that thoughts are, you know, a collection of people communicating back and forth. Obviously, they are, you know, they are. That's how knowledge is spread. That's how knowledge, grows on the earth, and how, you know, experience is cataloged through thoughts and talking and thinking. But I'm talking about thoughts that in solitude, or thoughts that are apart from the normal thinking. Thoughts that go outside the social intercourse of just talking and learning and speaking, professional speaking and whatnot, all the varied activities of business and teaching and philosophy and university talking, political discourse. I mean, all sorts of ideas out there. But to my mind, that's an exhausting universe, because does it allow for a single thought to exist by itself that has no relation to any other thoughts? I mean, is there such an idea as an original, unique thought that is not tied to anything else on the planet currently, that's a new emerging thought? So I've often wondered if that is possible. So thoughts, I guess I've turned to numbers, because numbers can sort of take the mind away from all the reoccurring feelings and emotions and meanings of words, the way they're normally intercoursed in speech. And if you translate them to numbers and quanta of numbers, and then maybe you can look at them differently, or you can strip them of their attachments to the cliches that they inhabit normally by using them. Like, I mean, any word you use, you know, people might respond to what you're saying by the value of what that word means over time, or what it has meant in social intercourse, or just conversational mode. Is there a way of arriving at a new meaning for the word that's stripped of all that, that has a pure underlying, not even an underlying, but an innocent, pure, detached meaning that is on a different level, maybe a primordial level? And maybe the primordial level is a higher level, or it's beyond the level that we're at now. I mean, my idea is that the Aquarian age is going to get so dense with static and thought and electrical impulses, and the mind is going to get so enervated and unnerved and agitated by the electricity of the age, the matrix that surrounds the planet now, and we'll go out into outer space. I mean, the entire consciousness will be electrified in the Aquarian age, which I put now numerologically in the parameters of 1961 to 3961 AD. Those are two points in time where the numbers themselves, the 1961 and the 3961, if you flip 1961, you get the same number, 1961. If you flip the number 3961, if you flip the number 3963, you get 3963. So this parameter between 1961 and 3963, to me, that's the interval of this devolving Aquarian age, which has flipped over to devolve for 2,000 years into a, where consciousness is stripped of its original adherence, its original spiritual meaning that's been accrued over, say, the last 24,000 years of time, when the sun went through all the zodiacal signs from
from the last after the last Aquarian age. So let's say from the last age of Capricorn till now, all that energy of thought has been a non-electrical thought. It's been organic thought that people relate to organically and evolves naturally with the earth as the earth evolves. Today, the thought is being electrified, meaning that the mind is being induced to react and to pulsate with electrical impulses that's not of the organic sphere that has been in play, not even in play, that has been on the earth since the beginning. I'm not sure if there's been another electrical age on the earth. There might have been, but in the last 24,000 years, there's been no manufactured electrical matrix. The only electricity has been in the, you know, in the sky, the thunder and the lightning, you know, and the ionization of the atmosphere. But to bring it to Earth and then use it to interact with human consciousness is a first to me, and it's going to dissuade the meaning of words, the organic emotional meanings of words and what they mean throughout time, throughout the years and eons of time. That's going to change from our organic rapport between people, or an organic symbiosis, an organic feeling of interaction verbally will change, because the words will be tinged with this electrical aberration. And in a very profound level, the electrical matrix, when it communicates ideas electrically, it has a physical reaction on the brain differently than if a person went off into a field and talked to someone one-on-one. I mean, the difference in communication today is different than it was 20,000 years ago. I mean, people communicated, you know, first of all, there may have not been as many people on Earth, and when they talked, they may have sat for hours and talked. But no one 24,000 years ago got on a telephone and chatted, or have some TV chatting to them and a radio talking to them and noise in the background and all these distractions of this Aquarian age, which I think are impeding the soul from retaining its organic relationship with the earth. The earth is being electrified in a sense. And the fact that it's flipped over, this 1961 is the same number. To me, that's a trick. That's a delusionary trick. That's an illusory trick of numbers. Like, okay, the earth and the sun and the planets are flipping over and going down in their course, but the number is the same. I mean, but it doesn't feel like anything has happened, but on a subtle metaphysical level, profound things have happened in that switch from 1961 onwards until it reaches 3963, when the Capricorn age will come back and the devolution of the Aquarian age will have ended. And at that point in history, I don't know how far the humanity will be out in space, but according to, I think it was Monroe, who traveled in his dreams, thought that around the fourth millennia, 4,000, 3,000 in that area, the Earth will start tending towards being more rural, or returning to rural existence. Like the matrix will have left at that end. And I don't know if it'll leave by catastrophe, if the Earth will just say, okay, enough of this artificiality on the planet. You know, the Earth can decide to get rid of it if it wants. I mean, the Earth has its own personality, it has its own power, and its own consciousness. So in the Capricorn age, it could easily, any kind of cataclysm could throw off the matrix, which would mean any artificiality that has entered the planet. I mean, from buildings to telephone poles to satellites going around the planet. I mean, everything that's been invented to somehow or other change consciousness. What has happened and what shall happen and will happen, there are two different words now. Shall doesn't contain ill, but will does. So there'll be good and evil on the planet in the next 2,000 years, but the balance of that, the agitation of that, the struggle of that will be so all-encompassing that it's going to affect the well-being of people. And until the Earth returns back in 3963 to the Capricorn age, at which point the entire solar system will have ascended in its arc as it spirals around the center of the galaxy, you know, a 2 million year orbit, and every 26,512 years, I think it is, you know, the sun makes a complete circuit in those 12 signs. As a, you know, if you see the Earth and the sun, you know, against the backdrop of the stars, billions of light years away, millions of light years away, thousands of light years away, and draw an imaginary line between the sun and those constellations, you know, every 2,160 years, the sun system, Loci 1 and its planets, are orientated differently to the planets, because they're moving, are orientated differently to the constellations and the outer galaxies, because the sun and the Earth are moving around the galaxy, like about a 2 million year journey around the center, around the entire galaxy. And we're on the, like, the outer two-thirds of the edge of it. So this journey ebbs and flows in height every 26,000 years. I mean, the height of it is the Capricorn age. The lowest point is the Cancerian age. So, you know, this arc spiral that goes around the galaxy, I don't know how many times, 26,000 times whatever equals 2 million. So, you know, 100, yeah, that would be about 100 times, yeah, is it about 100 times around the, so about 100 of those cycles of those, it's called the sidereal year, when the sun goes through all the 12 signs. So about 100 reiterations of that 100, of that 26,512 year span of time. So anyway, this age today, I don't know if individual thinking is necessarily individual anymore, or if it's really a truly democratic mind, whether the mind can be democratic in this age. I mean, I think the age is nefarious. It's a deceptive age, that the entire electrical industry is off-world. It's not organic. It's brought to the Earth, and it's brought by extraterrestrial alien forces that do not, are trying to control the consciousness. They're not on a exalted divine freeing mission. I mean, why would anyone visit the Earth other than to do something or to try to control something? I mean, the infinity of the universe is separated by such infinite spaces. Why would someone try to reduce space by traveling through it? I mean, why would even someone space travel? Why would someone want to get from this point to a place, you know, 10 light years away by going faster than the speed of light? I mean, what's the reason for that? And I would have to think it's the main vice of the fall. It's pride. The people aren't happy just existing. They have to do something else. There's something inside the soul that demands something that's not natural. And travel it. You know, you say, well, you can use the natural forces to travel faster than light. Well, that may be true, but the desire to, what's the reason behind it? It's conquest. I mean, getting minerals for civilization. I mean, the civilization is already deformed in its activity by the fall. I mean, the fact that predation exists, the fact that people have to, you know, struggle to eat, to live, to clothe themselves. I mean, that is not the way the heavenly worlds are. I mean, 90% of the universe, maybe even 95%, is benign, and they've already ascended into the spiritual realms where they don't have. I mean, just the fact that, say, at night, I went out this morning in the dark of the morning hours and looked at the sky and thought, why do I have a perception of like 50 feet? I mean, when I look up in the sky, I can only imagine 50 feet, because my experience as an organic body, of a soul inside of a limited organic body, can only apprehend 50 feet above my head. I mean, spatially, okay, there's 50 feet. There's a tree, that's 50 feet. But the intellectual part of the brain, mind, that says, well, okay, that constellation up above is 1,000 light years away. But the organic body and mind cannot imagine that. So why are those two realities different? Why is there one reality where you have this limited organic body, and the other reality in the mental sphere is that this constellation is 1,000 light years away? Those are two amazingly different spaces, but the human body inhabits and mind inhabits both those thoughts. So is one of those thoughts a reduction? So if we're spirit, the fact that we live on a body that can't imagine light years or imagine infinity, then wasn't that a controlled, something that controlled the human spirit to delimit its habitation from the infinite down to the finite? So that goes back to the questions of why was the human race created? I mean, why was this, who created the human race? I mean, and was it a nefarious creation, or was it a series of Genesis experiments somewhere, by different gods or competing gods or whatever? I mean, the universe, I'm sure, doesn't have the mind that the human being does, but the spirit of the human being, the spirit of the entire cosmos, has to be the equivalent in the sense of that's the equality of spirit. It's transcendent everywhere in the universe. So the mind of God could be as simple as a breath of wind or the beauty of sky. I mean, to even think of distances and light years and all these urges and desires of the human being to do things, to me that's an alien limited concept. We're not we're tended like animals to tend these limited spaces of bodies. But the spirit, I mean, the fact that the spirit, people die and go to the heavenly worlds, they're in different realities than we are here. I mean, how does one imagine an infinite reality when they're in a physical body? So the problem of the Aquarian Age, I see, is it's going to be a reductionism of the human body, the organic ability to empathize with the universal vibrations, the cosmic infinite vibrations, because the electrical matrix will suffocate the sensitivity of the organic nervous system. The nervous system of the spiritual, physical, mental sphere of the humanity is going to be anesthetized hindered by the electrical obfuscation of electricity. Now, it imitates a lot of things. The speed of electricity imitates a lot of the forces on the planet, but it's a manipulative type of energy that changes things, changes waves, changes... even if you see heat rising from a building, you see the way the air is distorted by heat coming off of a building. I mean, electricity is an invisible thing. I mean, Stephen Wright he made a joke about it once. He said he didn't pay his electric bill because he couldn't see the product he was buying. He couldn't see it, so he couldn't pay for it, which is a pretty profound joke, because that's sort of what is happening, that the human soul is paying for the price of this electrical matrix. We don't see it, but it's affecting us. And the payment is it's charging our soul with, I think, negativity, with negative... And my first symphony is about this. I mean, I cogitated on my first symphony for years. I mean, I wrote it when I was 31, but I started feeling the necessity of saying something to the world as early as 1961, when I was 7. I mean, that's when the electrical energy, I could feel the change in the Earth's body. I could feel it in the air. My nervous system could feel it. And I imagine the American Indians lived in a quieter world here in America 500 years ago, and a lot of people lived quietly. Today, I'm really suspicious of anything that makes noise. Uh-oh, are you still there? Still there recording. Anyway, so I'm not going to go on too long. I don't know how long this, much space I have on my computer, but I just think it's important to think. Make sure that you're thinking your own thoughts and you're not somebody else's abstracted, refracted thought is filling your mind. Because the electrical matrix actually goes faster than we can respond to it, because evolutionarily speaking, the brain of the human being has not yet evolved to really look at what's happening to it when the electric. I mean, even doctors looking at the human brain are using electricity to look into the brain. But electricity, it contains the word trick, folks. It without the K too, left out the K. But I know what the K. What happened to the K? The K was hit by a force. That the letter used to be two direct lines. It was caved into a K. But electricity should have that K in it to amplify that it's a trick. It's a trick of E. It's a trick of energy. So beware electricity, ladies and gentlemen. And have a peaceful year. 2022, the triple goddess, feminine power. All water signs, 2, 0, 2, and 2. All water signs next year. All right, take care.